I am really so honored to welcome to our midst Jane Pritchard, who's facing us over there, and who brings to us a wealth of wonderful knowledge, and she dispenses that knowledge in the most chatting way. Now, she actually, Jane and I met over 25 years ago in England when we did an exhibition together in Brighton, not in London. And it was about George Balanchine's small company, which he had put together before he came to New York to start ballet in America. He came in 1933. But our exhibition was called Ballet 1933, in fact, from Paris. And Jane and I did our first exhibition at Brighton, as I say. And then that exhibition came over to Saratoga, New York, where the New York City Ballet was an early resident of the most wonderful performing arts center. And then Jane has been for 11 years, I think over, the chief curator and organizer and collector for the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, which many of you may know, is a center for the arts of all kinds, and particularly art, you say art, artifacts, related design things. It's an amazing place. And Jane has been the chief curator for that museum. As a result, she did the most wonderful exhibition on Diaghilev, whom you may know of, and in Washington at the National Gallery. It was a tremendous success. And, well, there's so many things to say about Jane, but I will try to stick to things that you easily will recognize. The Diaghilev exhibition won an award here called the Anthony Denning Award for Theater Research. And then she's been a guest here. We're so lucky. Iris Fanger has had her as a guest from England, a little respite, I should say. And in connection with the Diaghilev, or at the time of the Diaghilev, she did a wonderful book on Anna Pavlova, about whom we'll hear now from her. And then another edition of the book has come out, and I wish we had the flyer for it. But you can find out about how you might get the book later. And so it is my honor to welcome Jane and all of you.
I just want to begin by saying that for me, it is a particular pleasure to be here at a series of lectures sponsored by Nancy Lassalle. She has meant a great deal to me. That work on that exhibition in Brighton and in Saratoga was very important. It was my first major exhibition and it was a very exciting experience. It was discovering a new area of dance. I just had sort of poked my nose in at a collection and discovered a wealth, and I wanted to share it with other people. So Nancy has been somebody who has given me encouragement and has been very important to me. I'd also like to take this opportunity of acknowledging the importance to me of Iris Fanger, who is very kindly inviting me and was partly behind my coming here, and I know gave a wonderful lecture last week. I wish I could have been at it. In 1984, I was awarded a Churchill Travel Fellowship, and that was to enable me to look at performing arts archives, particularly dance archives, in America, North America, Canada, and the USA. I arrived in Boston, that was my first port of call, and everyone was incredibly welcoming, Iris among them. Anna Pavlova. Yes, I wrote a book on her. It was a book written in a hurry, and it was written because in 2012, Ivy House, which became her London home, at that point was being run by the London Jewish Cultural Centre, and they wanted to mark the fact that Pavlova had lived there 100 years ago. And I was asked if I could get something together. They were thinking of something slightly more modest than I came up with. The reason that it became more lavish was because it was actually easier to market something that is more lavish than something that's very simple. And I wrote it in terms of Pavlova in Britain. A year later, they decided to market the book in America, and I said, you can't do that. My reason for it was that Pavlova is very important in America, and to have left out what seemed to me a significant chunk of her career for an American readership was wrong. So I insisted on having a second edition and an extra chapter and extra pictures. So in a way, I'm focusing on that part, but I will give, obviously, a broader context. I'm going to show you lots of images. I may not focus on them all in great detail. Just to sort of give you an idea, there's the book in the middle, very simple cover, but I think that sort of catches the eye, provided it's displayed correctly in a bookshop. A painting, this is an early sketch by Lavery of the Swan. He does a number of paintings of Pavlova. The far side, the portrait, is an American portrait taken in New York, and the wig she is wearing is for the dragonfly. And at the bottom, I think this is one of the things that makes me think Pavlova is a remarkable dancer. You see her, this is relates actually to a London season. In the middle, you see her in the swan costume. But round the side, these show that she was also dancing the works of other nationalities. Now, these weren't necessarily terribly accurate representations, but she does have this worldwide interest that is part of her career. As I say, America is crucially important to her career. A quarter of Pavlova's professional career is on the American continent. Now, I say continent, that includes South America as well, but she is over here an incredible length of time. And to me, that is very important. It is Pavlova who actually encourages so many people to dance, and still inspires people to dance, which I think is wonderful. And certainly touring around America, there was almost nowhere too small for her to go. When people said, why did she dance so often and travel so far? She said, well, how else can they see me? And so, I mean, this is something that's also, we will pick up back, how else could they see her? But there's a flyer from one of her triumphal North American tours. And there we have her, a couple of sort of images, obviously in America, a fashion pose really, a dancing pose, so New York, California. She really did travel the country. But to go back a bit in time, who was Pavlova, where did she come from? She was born in 1881, just outside St. Petersburg. She was probably illegitimate. Her actual family background is still fairly hazy. People have dug and dug, and they still haven't really found absolute certain authority for who her father was. Her mother was a laundress, and somehow, just after Marius Petipa's ballet, The Sleeping Beauty, had been created at the Mariinsky Theatre in 1890, she was taken by her mother to a performance. So actually how that came about is a bit of a mystery. But Pavlova was totally swept away by this. Her mother said, would she like to dance like one of the performers on stage? And she said, yes, she wanted to be the ballerina. And she never looked back. Basically, her career was set at that moment. She had to wait a year and a half before she could be accepted into the Imperial Ballet School, but she was. She was a good pupil, but she was an individual pupil. She was much slimmer than most of the dancers at that time. It wasn't that the dancers were particularly fat, but the build of women at that point was very different from now. And then in 1899, she graduated into the company. She worked as a ballerina. Well, she was quickly raised to the level of ballerina. And she was with that company, really, until 1914. She's for 10 years, that is her real focus. After that, she is looking elsewhere. And she literally sort of says that around 1910, she writes a letter in which she says that she feels that she's achieved what she's going to with the Imperial Ballet, and she's looking for other horizons. So I think in a way she does seem to be somebody who is quite clear-sighted. She performs a number of significant roles. There you see the cartoon that shows how slim she was at the time. Certainly in contrast, we see her as a young dancer in one of the solo roles in the Ballet Giselle. Here she is in a dramatic role, The Death of Nakia, in La Bayadere, and here as the Pharaoh's daughter. But her repertoire became very extensive, very interesting, and she was recognised as one of the leading dancers. Roles were also obviously created for her, and I've deliberately chosen to show you her as the fairy doll, the Spanish doll in the fairy doll. The fairy doll is something that recurs throughout her career, and apparently all the girls in the company, when it was her own company, wanted to do the Spanish dance because it had been created by Pavlova. So that was one that they all aspired to dancing. Significantly, in 1908 and 1909, she was the central figure in tours of Eastern Europe. Now, these were by a gentleman from Finland called Faeser, and he toured a group of dancers from the Imperial Ballet. This was basically like summer seasons, so when the Imperial Ballet was on holiday, they came together and they toured. And the programmes consisted either of one two-act ballet or two one-act ballets, and then was completed by a divertissement. That's a section of little numbers from other dances. And so what they were presenting was a full evening of ballet. This becomes the model for Pavlova's programmes when she sets up her own company. And I think it is also terribly important. We tend to think you go to the ballet, you will see ballet all evening. That was not generally the case in the 19th century. You would see ballet and you would see opera, or you would see some other thing. Ballet was not a separated art. And I think that Pavlova is absolutely key in turning ballet into a separate programme that stood in its own right. It's not something you actually read about in history books. Nobody's really sort of looked at it from. They think, oh, 19th century, they dance things called Swan Lake, Nutcracker, Sleeping Beauty. They're full evenings of entertainment. That's obviously what everybody saw. Yes, they might have in Russia. They didn't in Western Europe, and they didn't in America. So there's something that's really been changed, and Pavlova, I think, is crucial in that development. But I think also it's interesting in terms of the role she's dancing at this time. So we have La Female Garde Lisse. So this is a very light role, but one might sort of think of a soubrette type of character. And we also have Giselle, a very dramatic character. And this is one of the things that's important about Pavlova, her range as a performer. She could do everything and everything effectively. She wasn't just a dramatic dancer. She wasn't just somebody who did light little numbers. She could really sort of contribute to an overall programme. 1909, so following on from the second Faeser tour, Pavlova went to Paris and joined Diaghilev for his Saison Russe that introduced the Russian ballet to Western Europe, or is always said to introduce. There are other people working at the same time, but none of them have the publicity skills of Diaghilev. It's often said that, you know, Pavlova was a member of the company. She wasn't. She was a guest artist. There was no real company in 1909, but she was the star of the group, and she featured on the posters. Very famous poster there. One of two for the season. It was an opera and ballet season. The parallel poster was Shaliapin. And there we see some of the roles that she dances. But she only ever dances with Diaghilev in Paris in 1909 and in London in the autumn of 1911. She returns to dance with Diaghilev in London in 1911 to get the publicity, to be able to go on tour with her company around Britain and say, direct from Covent Garden. She's a clever woman, you know. She knows what she's doing. I think obviously, you know, just the thrill of dancing at Covent Garden was significant. And I find it absolutely fascinating when you parallel the two companies. In the 1911-12, Diaghilev's company is at Covent Garden. Pavlova is dancing in Music Hall at the Palace. But when you get to the 1920s, Diaghilev is hunting around London for a theatre to perform in, and Pavlova is sitting at Covent Garden. So how fortunes do change. So after the Paris season, she and one of the dancers who was also in the company, Mikhail Mordkin, went to London and performed in two soirees. And there are the works, the Russian Dance and then La Nuit, works that were performed by them at that time. But this was sort of a couple of performances. But I think the thing is that after 1909, internationally, promoters were on the lookout for Russian dancers to present. And that was American promoters as much as European promoters. And in 1910, she first comes to America. She arrives and performs at the Metropolitan Opera House, and that is at the end of an evening after opera. So Coppelia went on after an opera. You had very long evenings in the theatre. I think you must remember people came and went from the theatre a lot more than they do now. Now we go to the theatre, we usually sit in our seat dutifully and watch the performance from beginning to end, unless we're bored out of our minds, in which case we might disappear. But people would come for parts of performances in a much freer way than they do now. But what was remarkable was that most of the audience, or the audience that stayed, was delighted to have stayed, and that encouraged other people to come back. Also, at other performances, a divertissement, so the little numbers were presented, including works like The Swan that Mikhail Fokin had choreographed for her in St. Petersburg, and Val's Caprice, which was a wonderful lyrical pas de deux. And also, very, very significantly at this time, she and Mikhail Mordkin were performing the Bacchanal. And this was one of their most successful works. I think when the two of them were together, they really were an ideal pairing. It was the Fred and Ginger situation, sort of the giving class and sex, you know what I mean? So basically the two played off each other an amazing way. So they only were a partnership for 2 years, but it was something that really, I think, helped to cement Pavlova's career in the West. And it's certainly the Bacchanal was something that continues to be performed right the way through. And Malvina Hoffman goes on doing drawings, making sketches, making sculpture of this for the next sort of 20 years. So it is actually a very, very important, very lively work. And I think this is the thing, the works that Pavlova was presenting, they may not be complicated in terms of story, but they gave off great atmosphere, and audiences could easily relate to them. She gradually builds up her own company and starts touring with her own dancers. When she was first in America, it was just the two of them, and then using American dancers. She builds up her own company, initially bringing Russian dancers, but very quickly using English girls in particular. She then starts from 1912, really building up a repertoire of her own. Something like Amarilla, which is a work that she continues to dance right the way through, is really cobbled together extracts from works like Esmeralda. So she had no qualms about drawing on her heritage and having them recreated in a form that was more accessible for the audiences that she was dancing for. So that was a dramatic piece that was being performed. She does work in Paris, but she doesn't work in Paris very often. And these are just some sketches that we actually have at the Victoria and Albert Museum showing Pavlova about 1913, which means these will be performed in a very famous theatre, the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées, and it's later in that season that Diaghilev's company, with The Rite of Spring, will have its premiere there. But Pavlova was dancing at that theatre before Diaghilev's company. We tend not to put things together enough to really get a full picture. So just a little bit about Ivy House. Ivy House is in Hampstead. When Pavlova first came to London, she was very canny. She sussed out when she was on those couple of performances in 1909. She looked at the theatre scene and she understood that in Britain, traditionally, ballet was performed in music halls. It's a very big subject that I can't go into now, but she saw that and she thought, right then, that's how it works, that's the way I'll go. I can't afford to take on a huge theatre and have a big company, so I'll work within the means. And after her first season, she realised that this was something that she could come back to each year, and so she decided she would like a base in London. I think she found sympathetically it suited her. Hampstead at this time is just right outside the city. It's on a hill. It's got Hampstead Heath around it, lots of trees. She felt that she was in the countryside there, but there was easy access to the city and the West End. There was a tube train. She wasn't going to get on the tube, but never mind. It meant that when people were coming to her, it was easier. So she bought. So she first leased, and then in 1914 actually bought this house. And as you can see, it is a very beautiful house. There is this wonderful pond in front. It's a bit run down these days, I'm afraid. And unfortunately, the interior has all been torn apart. But what was very useful as well was the fact that there was this very large area that could be used as a studio and she could rehearse her company there. There were also basements that she could store her sets and costumes. So it became her sort of work base as well as her rest place. She loved the gardens. She filled them with birds and animals, encouraged them to, the wildlife to come there. And it was very much somewhere that she was at home. She was only at home there for relatively short periods of time. And there we see basically what a dancer does all the time, sews their shoes ready for the next performances. And she set up a small school. And there she is with just a few of her pupils. But interestingly, amongst the pupils from 1913 are two, Beatrice Griffiths, who became Griffova, and most of them had to Russianise their names, Muriel Popper, who became Muriel Stewart. Those two actually danced very extensively with Pavlova's company, and of course Muriel Stewart, a very important teacher in America. And as I say, a place to relax, to invite her friends to come to. And there we see her also with her partner offstage, Victor Dondre. Whether they were ever married is a moot point, but he served as her manager and her support throughout her career. Yes, Giacchetti, the great teacher, was there. In Russia, she had actually employed Giacchetti for a year to improve her technique. And when it was possible, she always took class with him. Indeed, she brought him to America on one of her tours. And touring really was the heart of what she did. She went everywhere, absolutely everywhere. That just gives you a little taster, everything from Liverpool to Yokohama, Egypt, obviously, there. And over the period of times, So basically travelling by sea and by rail wherever she went. So this is just a list to give you an idea of her visits to the USA. I've already mentioned March 1910. She's back again at the end of that year on a coast-to-coast tour. And that was basically with having built up her company and repertoire. Then there is a bit of a gap. She's back again in 1913 for this sort of winter season, and it tends to be the winters that she comes from. Look at the bottom of the list as well, October to March, October to April. And then during the war years, basically America becomes her haven. So she is here a great deal. So pre-war visits, gets a sense of some of the performances, very much the this is the 1910 Oriental production, so drawing on the success with Diaghilev's Scheherazade that everyone had heard about. Everyone needed their Middle Eastern ballet, Pavlova like the rest. And there was always a considerable element of folk dance in the programme. So there we have a Polish dance. And I can't help feeling that having those sort of works in the programme, when she was touring around with the different immigrant audiences, were going to pick up interest from different groups. I think she always knew what she was doing in that sort of sense. And of course, works were actually often created with the American tours in mind. Actually, in 1913 and 14, just before she comes to America, there will be performances in London which are really tryouts ready for America. And you can see that sort of pattern coming in. Of course, she is the one who brings Bakst as a designer to America. And significantly, she does present a number of the classics that are not seen elsewhere. And I think that's one thing we must remember. Very often it said, oh, Pavlova was old-fashioned. She did works from the 19th century. Well, yes, but those Petipa ballets had never been seen outside Russia, and she was bringing them out for the first time. And if you look at the repertoire of a company like American Ballet Theatre, they're performing all the works that Pavlova did. So I think that, you know, people need to reassess her importance in many ways. But yes, there were divertissements that she created inspired by America, such as Californian Poppy. She did wonderful solos like The Dragonfly, which was absolutely darting, very, very fast work, narrative works. And in the 1914-15 tour, obviously inspired by the castles, there was a whole programme of social dances. And the girls in the company were very sad when that finished, and they could no longer wear those lovely dresses. And they were all written up so that people could learn them. And then in 1916, and we're going to go on to the first video, first DVD clip here, she makes a film. We showed some of these things. Actually, in London, there was a programme that was sort of biographical with some reconstructed clips of Pavlova's repertoire introduced by Anthony Dowell, who got very interested in it. And then we're now going to see just some little moments from Dumb Girl. If we don't get the sound, it's not the end of the world.
Okay, let's just go on.
The main thing is to just get a sense of Pavlova in performance on screen. It's of course the story of Masaniello, the opera. So this is on the beach at Naples. So the pianist looking at the...
Oh.
actually some a further dance section has recently been rediscovered and would be available when they get the new print together. This is quite a famous section because it's often excerpted from the whole thing. And as you will notice, it is like sort of green screen or blue screen. Her partner's carefully dressed in black, but nobody thought about the hands. Photoshop didn't exist then.
They're playing it as an Dora Duncan.
She gets a chance to do the stage version of the Dumb Girl of Portici. And as I say, they were the opera ballet. She already had used some opera music, opera ballet music, for her repertoire. And she also adds in a few things like snowflakes from the Nutcracker, so that if the opera that's being performed doesn't have a ballet section, they can perform a ballet at the end of the opera. But it gives a refreshment to the repertoire. It gives a different programme for audiences to see. And there was also, I think, something very clever about building up a repertoire of opera ballet. When they were on tour, they relied on musicians wherever they were. They didn't tour their own musicians. They toured a conductor and they toured a pianist. But other than that, they were dependent on local musicians. Now, many of those musicians would know the music for opera ballets, but they might not know, it was absolutely pointless trying to do, say, Stravinsky, because they wouldn't have known how to play it. And so she was actually doing something very sensible in building up a repertoire of well-known music being danced to that would then be played reasonably well wherever she went. I think things like that very much sort of come into play. Often Pavlova is criticised for her old-fashioned use of music, but I think she was being practical as much as anything. So she does this on a tour, different repertoire, loses all her money again, back at square one. That's what happens if you're in the theatre. So, 1916, she goes to New York and she performs The Sleeping Beauty in 48 minutes. It actually gets down, I think, to 18 minutes. And a divertissement is added to it. So this is based on the Marius Petipa choreography, very much adapted, designed by Leon Bakst, and because Bakst had designed this, he was able to throw it together quickly for Diaghilev in 1921. But it just didn't quite work within the context of Dillingham's big show at the Hippodrome. So it's performed and then gradually it gets shorter and shorter and longer divertissement added and the shift goes over. But this is the point when Diaghilev's company is touring around America. So she's not in competition. She's doing something different. Also, it gives her a chance to refresh her company, to open a school for a brief period and build up dancers. Dancers had come from England. Some of them had had enough of touring around America. Some other of the English girls, such as Muriel Stewart, who was too young initially to come, got on a ship and came out and joined the company during the seasons here. She picked up some American dancers, and she picked up, in particular, American men. The men were largely trained in acrobatics and athletics. Many of them didn't have a dance training, but she could use them. And so previously she'd used largely Polish men, but obviously during the war it was more difficult to acquire performers from Europe. And so she was making do with what she could get. And after The Sleeping Beauty, off she went to South America. So she's in South America for the period basically 1917 to 20. She does a tour around South America, basically going, let me see, that's anti-clockwise. then she goes round clockwise, and then she has another half round clockwise. So she goes absolutely everywhere. And I think in many ways this is one of the more relaxed periods of her touring, because there are much longer seasons. There are, in America usually, it was three performances at a venue. That would be one evening and then the next day a matinee and an evening. Next day move on to another place. It was exhausting. In South America they were frequently for 1 or 2 weeks in a place, which I think was, the dancers loved the fact that quite often there were longer rehearsal periods and they could rush off to the beach when they were in appropriate places. But again, they went absolutely everywhere. And it must have been pretty tough on them. Also, I think, quite adventurous. It was a relatively small company and I think they became very closely bonded group at that time. Works were specially created for them. The Syrian dance, we have all our American men in there, along with Pavlova and Hubert Suet's actually very significant. Elements of the Sleeping Beauty were resurrected. New dances inspired by where they were, such as the Mexican dance, being created for them. And then Pavlova created her own only work for the company. She created a lot of divertissement for herself, but this was the only actual ballet that she choreographed, a work called Autumn Leaves. And it was always said by the dancers that they dreaded having Autumn Leaves in the programme because they would have to do extra rehearsals beforehand because Madame was never happy with the results. So there we have, and it's a work that gets redesigned at different periods. And this happens with quite a number of the ballets. They are redesigned during the long tours. So after the war, Pavlova doesn't rush back to Europe. She remains for a period. I think she realised that there was going to take time for Europe to get back on its feet. The dancers were quite nervous about what was going to happen when they got back to Europe, quite understandably. But actually, from 1920, Ivy House again becomes her base. She will do seasons in Britain virtually every year, and then she expands her horizons through the 1920s and tours to Asia, to Australia, as well as to America. Very often, her seasons at Covent Garden will be preparation. So the season at Covent Garden will be sort of September, and then she will come to America bringing the new or the refreshed repertoire for the American audience. So including works such as Don Quixote, drawing on Russian traditions with old Russian folklore, which was very similar in terms of its narrative to Cocteau, and also adding in works inspired by her Oriental tours. So there is this real variety that comes through at this point. Core works like The Fairy Doll surviving, and we have the two different versions that were created for Pavlova's company. It's very interesting that in the late 20th century, a survey was done about people who had seen Pavlova and what did they remember. Of course, top of the list was The Dying Swan, but second on the list was The Fairy Doll. And I think that was because it was a work, it's a fairy tale work that appeals to children. And I suspect most of the people who were being interviewed had been very young at the time, and therefore it was exactly what would have appealed to them. So I think there might have been an element of, you know, sort of age that actually coloured the memories that were there. Very famous for Pavlova wearing a huge pink tutu at the centre of it. This is actually based on a late 19th century Viennese ballet that was actually one of the most popular works at the end of the 19th century. A work very little performed now, although the Vienna Ballet does still keep it alive. And in 1928, Pavlova returned to South America. She was less ecstatically received there on that occasion, although I think for some people there was a sense of nostalgia for her return. One of the images on that screen I find particularly fascinated, and it's this picture. Pavlova in a rehearsal tutu costume at the time. Any of you who know George Balanchine's ballet Apollo, and we're always told that when Chanel redesigns it, it's partly inspired by what dancers were wearing in rehearsals. Well, we have 1928. What's Pavlova wearing? Look at the ties around it. So if you happen to know those second costumes for the muses in Apollo, I think you can see how it was a style of rehearsal wear at the time. But that gives a sense of the productions at the time. When Pavlova toured, as I said, the programmes were often two one-act ballets and then the divertissement. Pavlova usually danced the second of the one-act ballets. If it was something like Giselle, she'd do the two acts, of course. And then she would be in either two or three of the divertissement. So she wasn't in everything. It did make it possible for a dancer to take on that much work. But I have only found, I think, two performances in Peru in the teens at which she didn't actually dance. So if Pavlova didn't dance, the company didn't earn money. So the strain on her, obviously, was huge. In the latter part of the 20s, America was suffering in terms of financial approach. So Pavlova wasn't going there. She was looking to Australia and Asia to help keep the company going. She did work, as I say, incredibly hard. She died at the age of 50 in 1931. She was at the beginning of a new tour. They had set out. There had been a train accident. She had caught a chill. She had pleurisy or pneumonia, and she died in The Hague. Yes, they did. Yes, I loved that when I found that. So often these sort of illusions. Any of you who are looking, there we are. But of course, you know, publicity and all the rest of it. That's actually a card that we have in our collection at the V&A. So that sort of information. But I don't want to leave us on sort of the down notes. Pavlova didn't have much of a private life, and we don't know a lot about it. But she did actually have talents. She actually was a sculptor in her spare time. And I just love, there's a whole series of photos of her in Italy with the artist Alexandra Yakilov, and they always look so happy together. So, well, one can take whatever impression one wants from that. But it's nice to feel that there were moments that she did get a chance to relax. When she was on tour, she was always performing. When she left the theatre, she gave a performance, basically, as she left. She was always very gracious to the people waiting at the stage door. She would obviously share her flowers with them. Just as didn't matter what happened, she would always give wonderful curtain calls. And so the impression that she gave was important. When she toured, she was available to see people, to give interviews, to often sort of to sort of talk to young dancers and things. So she didn't sort of cut herself off. She had a very, very heavy workload.
The image of Pavlova as the swan, the dying swan, the work that Mikhail Fokin created for her, absolutely inseparable from the ballerina. She loved swans. She had her own swans. Successive swans were called Jack. And yes, they did sing. There we are. And it's images like that that then inspired when Matthew Bourne was doing his Swan Lake for his initial publicity. He basically took that image and used it. So one can see that the iconography of Pavlova lives and is current for choreographers, for the for marketing, as much now as in the past. Pavlova on screen, I've already shown you her as a film star, and I think it's very important. She is the first ballerina who takes film seriously, and so that we do have something of a record of her career. She first was filmed, we believe, in 1911, actually for a gala that she couldn't perform at. And because she couldn't be there, she was filmed and the film was sent along. That has not yet been found. But I think it suggests that she becomes very aware early on of the value of film. She does film some of her repertoire, and we will see just a little bit of that in a minute. She filmed it partly because she wanted people to be able to learn from her. There was an educational side. And actually for her last tours, to Australia and the Far East and Middle East, she was filming as she went. She actually tried to film productions on stage, including Don Quixote. She didn't actually have the skill and the equipment to do it, but she was actually trying to make dance accessible to a wider audience. She would have loved the big screens and the opportunity for her work to have been seen everywhere. And perhaps she wouldn't have had to tour quite so much because people would have had an alternative way of seeing her. It's interesting because most of her dancers in later life said, oh, you shouldn't look at the films, they don't do her justice. Well, we all know that nobody ever thinks that films do dancers justice, but they are very valuable. And to have the films, even imperfect, I think is a real asset. There is a legacy in costumes, not only in costumes just because they have been preserved, but also her costumes were frequently made by her dresser, Madame Manya, who came from Russia with her. And Madame Manya and how Manya made tutus is how a British tutu is made. Now, you might think that's not relevant to America, but the number of American productions that are actually made by British workshops is pretty high. And so that style of tutu is important. Alicia Markova went to Madame Manya after Pavlova's death and asked her to make her tutus. Markova then took her tutus to the Vicwells company, the company that ultimately becomes the Royal Ballet. They studied those tutus, and that becomes the template for the way the Royal Ballet wardrobe makes a tutu. So from Pavlova, that whole sort of school of tutus. I always think the two most important people in the development of the tutus, you can tell me I'm wrong, are Madame Manya and Karinska. So she inspired young dancers. Dancers who were with the company. So in the group here, we have Vera Fredova, for example, who is more famous as Winifred Edwards, taught both in California and indeed very importantly in London. Muriel Stewart, who taught in America, particularly in New York, the School of American Ballet. Ruth Page joined the company for the second of the South American tours, so basically starting going down through Brazil. And Agnes de Mille never actually danced with Pavlova, but was inspired, totally inspired by seeing Pavlova. And that's only just a handful of people who were inspired. And so I think the legacy continues through the second and third generations. And then for a choreographer like Frederick Ashton, he saw Pavlova, and he said, I was injected by the poison. So basically, seeing Pavlova inspired him. He signed his ballets generally with an enchaînement, a group of steps from the Gavotte Pavlova, and so that becomes his sort of signature piece. He saw Pavlova in Lima, Peru. He went in a car, and it was his first outing in a car. He was terribly excited about that. His brother thought the car was more interesting. He eventually thought that the ballet was more interesting. It's always said that he saw her in 1917, but the two ballets that he said he saw were only performed together in 1918 when they went back. So I think he saw her on the second visit, unless he amalgamates things in his imagination. And I think this is because most people don't look at the whole of Pavlova's career and understand actually how much she did. And it wasn't that she went to centres one time. She would go back and she would do more work there. And so it wasn't necessarily the first performance people saw. It could be a subsequent performance. But those are images that basically the Gavotte Pavlova is where the enchaînement came from, that he used his Marguerite d'Armand, very much inspired by Christmas. A work like Thais, with the sort of drifting around, absolutely Pavlovan in its style. And so that's basically my series of images, but I have a chance to show you just a little piece of footage of Pavlova dancing. This is footage made, we believe, in 1925. at the end of her last visit to the United States. Pavlova made two blocks of films in America. The first, actually, as we understand it, did have sound when they were made. It was very much an experimental film of the time. But the films I'm showing you, going to be showing you now, were made in Hollywood and were really an opportunity for her to record some of her works. So these are made towards the end of her career. They are not ideally filmed. People hadn't really learned about how to film dance. And so it's basically plonk a camera and hope for the best.
And how many books on Pavlova have you been involved in?
I've only done the one book on Pavlova. Obviously, there is a considerable industry of writing on Pavlova. I know somebody is now working on a complete biography. There have been biographies in the past. None of them are fully accurate. Nobody has worked out her entire repertoire. There's huge areas that haven't been looked at. And I am particularly interested actually in her dancers and who they were, where they came from, how long they danced with her, and actually what the programs were. So there are books that are around and are lovely. I don't think any of us have got the full story. And I deliberately, when I was asked to do a book, I said, there's no way I'm trying to do a biography. I'm only going to do something that gives an impression and perhaps sort of adds to the way people think about her and think about her as an important woman.
Mm-hmm. Yes. What's her status in Russia now, since she obviously didn't go back to Russia after she left, right? Did she go back to Russia?
No, she didn't go back after the war or revolution.
Okay, so after 19.
So basically, during the period up to the revolution, up to the war, she would go back each year. She would often go back and do sort of a handful of performances probably about three works. Mm-hmm. So she was sort of putting in appearance, and that was much appreciated. And in fact, one of her last visits, she was outside the time of the Imperial Ballet season, and so she performed in popular theatre. And she actually took two English girls with her, which I think that's an extraordinary thing to have happened at that time, but never much commented on. Her status in... she always seems to have had regard in Russia. She never sort of disappears from the pantheon there. So whereas with some dancers, they don't seem to become so well known. Yes, she always was. When Russians came out and there was a small museum for a while at Ivy House, they would always be going and visiting that. Mm-hmm. They're still trying to fight to get the ashes back in Russia.
Be careful.
Well, it's those of us who work in dance, we've met over the years different people who did dance with Pavlova, and I knew Ruth Page. I grew up in Chicago, and Ruth Page once told me that the first time she met Anna Pavlova, she knocked on her dressing room door, the door opened, and there stood Pavlova nude, and she said, and she was very young at the time, but you do have to remember that dancers, their body is just part your instrument, and there was nothing salacious about that at all. But Ruth Page liked to tell that story.
What's the difference in the design of the tutus? You said the American and the European designs. You mentioned that.
Well, it's not so much sort of, what I'm saying is that quite often the British tutus are used for American productions because American designers will actually use British costumiers at times.
What's the difference?
I think it's largely in the way the whole sort of the tutu is built. The skirt is built. And certainly there are, I think it's not so, it's not, I don't think I can really call it a British and an American tutu. I think you've got to look at the makers and how they approach it. But with, say, a Korinska tutu, it tends to be much softer. A British tutu tends to be sort of built up, but not as hard, and you won't be so aware of the hoop as you will be, say, in a Russian tutu. You get your eye in, you start sort of seeing things. But I think the thing is that
prior to Mania, our tutus were not really very well shaped. They were still longer, and obviously during the period of Pavlova's life, the tutu does get shorter. She's still wearing quite large tutus for a number of the productions, and they do vary. It's not just that there is one tutu. Mania could adjust. But I think that the sizing of each layer comes through from the way Mania did. There's no proper documentation. Nobody interviewed her in a way that I think we would be doing now if we had the opportunity to talk to somebody of that status. So it's actually a case of going back. And so when I was showing you the costume that Markova wore, that is, I think, a very good example of seeing. It's a very short tutu because we got into the 30s. That's from a Markova Dolan Company production in the 1930s, so it is relatively shorter than most Pavlova ones. But in the way it is made and the use of the layers and the colouring, I think, comes through from the way that Mania always made the Pavlova. Oh, sorry.
Jane, can you comment on the influence of Isadora Duncan on Anna Pavlova?
Well, I think Duncan and the Duncan style was hugely important on a very wide basis. Certainly, Anna Pavlova saw Duncan in Russia, and with Fokine, although Fokine likes to say he's not influenced, whether it's a specific influence or a general influence is there. So yes, there is increasing use of that sort of free-flowing movement, the richness of the upper body coming through, the use of the tunic, the sort of the Greek element that you will see in a lot of... So yes, Pavlova does have an intersection with what Duncan was doing. And of course they are also using some of the same music. The use of Chopin, for example, goes very, very sort of broad. It's very much, I think, part of the style of dance. It's epitomised often with Duncan, but she's not the only person doing that. There's a lot of others, and it's a style that's picked up and used by many dancers.
Thank you, Jane.